Ready, Bro?
Yep.
Well, good morning, everyone. We are continuing our discussion about what we as a community, and let me be specific when I say as a community, the Black community, the descendants of former slaves, those who have historically been denied equality, inclusion, due consideration, fair consideration. This conversation is about what we need to do to get beyond this cyclical struggle that we've been talking about for the last 7 weeks. Actually, 8 weeks. We did session six twice because there were some technical issues. But folks, this is real. And I do believe that this material that I'm sharing with you and that I have shared with you in the past and that I will share with you today is divinely inspired material. In other words, God does not want us to believe that we are left to the devices and to the goodwill of other people. We are today, we were yesterday, and we will always be in God's hand. It's Him who has a plan. And God is not trying to figure out how He's going to get us to the destination. God is proactive, God has a plan, and He's revealing that to men and women. And He has reached down and touched me and prompted me, and even I would say prodded me to speak these words. And so I'm going to speak them. A lot of what I will speak about today, although we're talking Black history, it's biblical and it's prophetic. So let's begin. We're now in section three, if you recall by way of review. This course, this seminar, is divided into three sections. Each section has three sessions or three lectures. So this is section three, session seven. And now what we're talking about, because we've been identifying the problem, the various reasons for why we are in the state that we're in, but if that's all we do, that's not really productive. That's not beneficial to us and to our children and to their children and to our community. Now, ultimately, I think that the purpose for learning is so that we can take action, so that we can be people of substance, so that we can be people of influence, so that we can be people of impact. So then that's the title of this lecture, Reaching the Solutions to the Problem. As always, I'd like to start off by reading the scripture. And today what we're going to be talking about is vision. You know, when something happens horrible in the Black community, if there's a police shooting or the police kill a Black man and it's shown on television, we get up in arms about it, whether it's in Cleveland or New York or Los Angeles or Houston. We feel a sense of injury as though it actually happened to us, because in one sense it is happening to us because we are connected. We talked about that in previous sessions, how we are connected, how we're having a common experience. We're not absolutely monolithic, but we are substantially monolithic in terms of how the majority population view us, in terms of how we act. And we noted that that was particularly true as it relates to spirituality, that we are spiritual people. And we said that that includes, of course, religion, but it is not only religion. It is how we approach the world. It is having dreams and believing that they are significant. It is expressing our spirituality in our dance, even in our sports, in the end zone, The old celebration dance, which at one point was banned and considered to be inappropriate, now it happens all the time because we bring our spiritual expression to everything that we do. And that's not a good or bad thing, but it's certainly something that we need to embrace and not allow people to persuade us that it's inappropriate. So let me start with the scripture. Scripture is Habakkuk. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. That's Habakkuk, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And I know that you've heard this scripture read many times, and I'm going to set it up in context in the sense that back in 2017, I traveled to China. Don't ask me what possessed me to go to China, but I went there with some friends. And we were all African American, we weren't Chinese. We went there though for a 7 day period, 17 day period. I, as a student of history and as a student, particularly of civilizations, I've always been fascinated by the Chinese civilization because it has existed for so long, as in 5,000 years or more. And you can say what you want about the Chinese. If they've been around for 5,000 years, they've learned to do some things that work, and that's something that we can actually learn from, we can benefit from. I'm not saying that obviously everything that they do is good, or their particular form of government, which is communism, is something that we should embrace. But their structure, the way that they approach how they keep their civilization, their society, their country together. We, at this time in America, when we're coming apart literally at the seams, when people are talking about taking up arms against the government as recent as Monday and Tuesday of this week, people are seriously talking about engaging in acts of civil war, which are further acts of treason. We can learn something from societies that have been around for 5,000 years, not 500 years, 5,000 years. The average lifetime or the lifespan of an empire is about 300 years. If you look at all the empires that have ever existed and you average them out, the average lifespan is 300 years. America has been around for 250 years, give or take. So we're on the backside. If all things hold steady in terms of the trends of society, we are performing in such a way to suggest, to strongly indicate that we're not going to surpass that average. And I'm just talking strictly objective data and what I see in human history. So then when we look at a country or a nation or an empire, if you want to call it that, like China, the question is, how did they manage to do it? Well, one thing is that one of the indicators that a nation is going to be around for a long period of time is the degree of commonality that the citizens share, and or the degree of adhesion. And we'll talk about that in future lectures. We only have two more, but we'll talk about it. The glue, the natural glue, what is it that bonds people together? Because whatever that glue is, that's an indicator of whether the people are going to be able to stay together over a long period of time. So the thing that holds China together, it's not magic, it's not political ideology, it's blood, it's sanguinity. 90% of the people that live in China has about 1.4 to 1.5 billion people living in it. The number one glue that has held any civilization together, if you look at all of the civilizations that have ever existed, the number one glue is blood. I mean, they're related. 90%, there are different ethnic groups within the nation of China, but 90% of the people who live in China are members of the Han, the Han, ethnic group. So essentially, when you talk about an ethnic group, what you need to understand is that that group descended from one person. In other words, 90% of the people in China, a billion of them are family. So that's a cue, and we don't have that in the United States. Diversity can be a strength, but it can also be a weakness. We'll talk about that in terms of what Daniel saw in his prophecy, or actually King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream of a great image. And when Daniel constructed, which means interpreted that dream, he looked at the feet, which were part clay and part iron. And what Daniel said is this is the revelation that God gave Daniel, the feet that were part clay and part iron represented people who were of diverse ethnic origin, living amongst each other, mingling, but never clinging. So it's interesting, and this is just some side reading that I encourage you to do, and we'll talk about it more later, that when this great image, which represented all the empires that had ever existed, or the superpowers, at the time that Nebuchadnezzar was living, all the way to the end of time. So that when you look at that prophecy that is in the book of Daniel chapter 2, you look at it very carefully, what you need to understand and appreciate is that it's futuristic as well. In other words, it's not complete. But what is striking is that image was struck not in the head where the brain is. You would think if you're trying to kill something, you hit it in the head. No, not in the chest where the vital organs are, the heart and the lung. No, hit it on the feet. And the feet represented a diverse empire where people mingled, but they never cleaned. See, that's the issue that has always brought down most empires. It wasn't the lack of a common set of political ideas, because that is a type of adhesion, or that's a type of glue that holds people together, but it's the weakest form. Family, blood is the number one. The second thing that holds people together over time seems to be religion. You're Christian. You gather under that flag. If you're a Muslim, you gather under that flag. If you're Sikh, you gather under that flag. If you're Hindu, you gather under that flag. So religion is a glue, but it's not as strong as family. Political ideology, i.e. we believe in democracy, we believe in a republic democracy, or some republican form of democracy. When I say republican, I don't mean as in the party, I mean as in a government that is an indirect democracy, where we elect people who go to Congress and make decisions on our behalf. That's a republican form of democracy. Whatever our alleged ideology is, it's the weakest form of glue, and I'm using that term metaphorically, meaning that which holds people together over time. Political ideology is the weakest form of glue. And unfortunately, folks, in this country, that's the main thing that we have. We don't have blood, and we, at this point, we can't really say in all honesty that this country is a Christian nation, even though we claim to be, but America is becoming increasingly secular. I do a lot of digressing. I'm going to read the scripture, but I'm just sharing with you. So getting back to China, I'm studying China, and I'm struck by the fact that they've been around for 5,000 years. And I'm further struck when I learned through the tour guide who was giving us the full story of China. He tells us that 90% are Han Chinese, which are their one family. So, but what really impressed me about China, or I don't say impressed me, but it moved me, it caused me to think, was two things. One was that on the state-run TV, they were showing images of Black people, particularly Black men that were being beat up by the police. And they were saying, this is what America is really about. On the state-run TV in China, this is what democracy actually looks like on the ground in America. And I remember having a conversation with some of the white people that were traveling with me who were from the United States, and they were certainly put out by that presentation of America, and they wanted to have a conversation. And I was like, well, bro, they're not distorting things. They didn't make up something. These weren't what we call deep fades or deep fakes. I can't recall which term it is, but it's when you create a video and you make it look like it's real, but it's actually made up. They were showing actual images. So if we don't like for America to have a bad name and a bad reputation around the world, then we need to behave. We need to conduct ourselves according to these lived or these alleged principles of freedom and inclusion and equality that we say we believe in. So I was struck by the fact that the Chinese were calling us on that. Almost every time that I turned the TV on, I was seeing some image, and it was always a white officer, and for the most part, a black man being beat up by the police. So that's what Chinese people think about us in America, by the way, because we give them that opportunity. But the next thing that's more positive that I want to talk about is that I was struck by is they were talking about their 100-year plan. See, the Chinese have a plan, and that's dovetails into our lecture, our session today. They have a 100-year plan, at least minimally a 100-year plan. I'm struck because in this country, we only think in 2-year increments, general election and midterms, general election and midterms. We don't have vision, and we're just hoping that things will work out for us, when in fact, hope is not a plan at all. Hope is not a strategy at all. We need a plan, we need a vision. And the plan has to come from or flow from the vision. So as you listen to this lecture, and you will have the opportunity, and I really would like to get your input when we get to the backside, because question number one is that I'm going to ask you is, what is your vision? If someone were to ask you to write a 100-year vision for Black people in America, in other words, 100 years from now, if everything that you wanted to see happen for Black people in this country was happening, what is that? What does it look like? You know, people come into my office and they often ask me, you know, can we win? And I always tell them there's no guarantees. But then after they ask me their questions, the number one question that I have for them is what I call the judge or the jury question, which is, if I'm the judge and I'm going to give you everything that you want, what is that? What's amazing is that very often people will say to me, I don't know. I don't know. And I can tell you this, whether we're talking individually, whether we're talking collectively as a group, if you don't know with precision where you're trying to go, you won't ever get there. I don't know is not a destination. And I know that we tend to kind of live in a reactionary mode. And what this lecture is about is that we've got to get beyond the reactionary stage. Reaction is not a vision. It is not leadership. Now, again, when bad things happen to the members of our community, I think we should be vociferous about it. We should use every means and every mode to articulate our concern and our outrage, and we should demand justice. And we should demand that the right thing be done, but it's not a plan. It's not a vision, and it's certainly not a 100-year vision. So we have to be engaged and with intentionality, long-range thinking about where we want to end up. And you know what? Here's the thing that we got to get away from, which is Western. Part of the reason why we don't do the long-range thinking like the Chinese, and I'm not praising the Chinese, what I am praising is a civilization that has been around for 5,000 years and saying to us that we can learn something from them. But part of the reason why we don't tend to do long-range planning of that nature in the West is because we are in it from ourselves and ourselves only, for me. Even so, to the point where I don't care what's going to happen to my grandchildren or their children, as long as I'm comfortable, as long as I can live a good life. But the Bible tells us, if I recall reading the Bible correctly, that a good man leaves a legacy for his children and his children's children. In other words, from a biblical perspective, we are required not just to be thinking about ourselves, but our children and their children. So long-range planning is what we're talking about. I think I've done enough, so let me read the scriptures, and I'm reading from the New King James Version, Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. If you recall last week's lecture, I was talking about Nehemiah and Ezra, who came back from Babylon after the 70-year captivity, and they, pardon me, they were trying to build a wall. And the wall represented God's protection, and then ultimately they were going to rebuild the temple, which represented God's presence among them. And as they engaged in that process, their enemies came up and tried to thwart their efforts, first through saying that they were with them and they wanted to collaborate. And I stress the fact that it's so important for us to be particular about who we collaborate with, especially when it comes to our future. And Nehemiah and Ezra were discerning in the sense that they knew that those people weren't really for them. And after they cleared all that up, they continued to build a wall, but in one hand they had bricks and mortar, and in the other hand they had their sword or their spear. And that, as I said, was a picture of watchfulness. Now I want to connect those two lectures, tell you that there's a connection between watchfulness and vision. Let me show you in the scripture. Habakkuk says, I will stand on my watch. You see that word? That's an important word. And set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I am corrected. Then the Lord answered and said unto me, write the vision and make it plain on tablets that he may run who reads it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and it will not lie. That means it will not tarry. Though it tarries, wait for it. Because it will surely come, it will not tarry. And I'll stop there at verse 3. So it's a powerful thing that Habakkuk says here. First of all, he says, I'm going to be watchful. And I'm going to wait on God to give me a word from heaven that I can write down and then share it with my people. Now, this vision, this plan, it's a vision, I'll say that because the scriptures literally refers to it as such. It may be not just something that pertains to me. It may not come to complete fruition until I'm dead and gone. But here's the question that I have for everyone that's in this class. Are you prepared to make sacrifices today for something that may never personally benefit you, but will benefit your children and their children? If you're not, we're never going to overcome as a people. We are never going to get to the promised land. We don't understand that it is required of us. It is required of us to make sacrifices that we may not personally benefit from. If Jesus Christ in heaven only did what personally benefited us, or him rather, where would we be? Right? It didn't personally benefit Jesus to come down to in human form and to teach and then to offer himself up on Calvary's cross, but it certainly benefited us. And if we have the mind of Christ in us, one of the things that we've got to understand is Jesus said, whoever wants to be my disciple must first deny himself. And deny himself means don't put yourself first. At the bare minimum, that's what it means. Don't put yourself first and think only about your personal needs, because there's no way that the group is going to move forward if every individual person in the group is thinking about what's only best for him. I got to pursue my truth. I got to live my life. I got to be free. I've got to be happy. All the things that we heard, for those of you who are somewhere in my age range or older, in the 70s, that's what it was all about. I've got to be free. I. When the vision is for the group, we talk about God so loved the world, so we know that God loves the world, and we talk about the fact that individuals can be born again, but we kind of skip, and I've talked about this in prior sessions, the fact that God is very detailed and very systematic. He doesn't jump from the world to the individuals. God has a plan for salvation, which entails specific strategies to reach people in North America, to reach people in Africa, to reach people in Europe. He's got a plan to reach the Gurleys. He's got a plan to reach the Fillmores. He's got a plan to reach the Chambers. He's got a plan to reach the Birdsongs. God's got a plan. And success looks like finding out what that plan is and walking in it, embracing it. And in the context of this lecture, in the context of this course, this seminar, I'm telling you, we're not just floating. We're not at the mercy of other people. We're in God's hands, and that's where we always have been. Let me read the second scripture, Proverbs 29 and 18. And you've seen this scripture before. It reads a little different in the New King James. I'll read it and then I'll translate back to the King James. But what it says is where there is no revelation, because I think that's a good reading, because what happens, what vision is revelation from God. In other words, the ability to see the future is only possible through supernatural means. And where there is no revelation, which then of course leads to vision, it says here, the people cast off restraint. That means they run amok. But happy is he who keeps the law. The old King James says simply, where there is no vision, the people perish. They perish because they're living their lives in such a destructive, selfish, consuming, hedonistic, and that means, when I talk about hedonism, I'm talking about the pursuit of pleasure and the thought that only that which brings me pleasure is good and that which causes me discomfort is evil. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. But it starts with a vision. So again, I'm asking you, as we go through this conversation, and I'm gonna give you the chance to speak, and you know, when you share, consider that there's no right or wrong answer. But if you could write the vision for Black people that will be in effect 100 years from now, what would that look like? All right, so now let me move on into this, further into the lecture. We have something that I'm going to refer to, and I have referred to in the outline, as moral currency. I'm going to define that because it is my made-up term to discuss a concept or a phenomenon that we are all familiar with. See, moral currency is the idea or the notion that people generally, because we are created in the likeness and the image of God, and we have some basic sense of what is right and what is wrong and what is fair and what is just. No matter where we live on planet Earth, or when we live there, God put inside of every human being a basic sense of what is right and what is wrong. And in every civilization, there's some version of thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. We get those from the Ten Commandments, but actually 1,000 years before that, the Egyptians had this system that they call Maat, M-A-A-T, and if you look at Maat, it's because it's a code written out. If you look at the M-A-A-T, I'm not not elevating their religion, but I'm trying to tell you that what's the common thread is that God has revealed the truth to everybody on planet Earth. And there have been people who've chosen to ignore it. But God has made it so that every people on planet Earth at any point in time understood what was basically required of him. You know why that is? As a lawyer, I appreciate that more than I ever appreciated it when I was a minister. There's a concept called due process. It means the government can't take any action, any punitive action against you if it hasn't previously made you aware that here's the standard. And if you deviate from that standard, there's going to be consequences. And within the concept of due process, that's called notice. And often when I'm lecturing about notice, the concept of notice, I talk about the fact that when you go to an intersection, if you're in Germany, if you're in Japan, if you're in Italy, if you're in China, if you go to an intersection and you see a red octagon sign at that intersection, whether you read Chinese or Mandarin or Italian or French, you know what to do because you've been put on notice. That's what the stop sign is there for. Similarly, when you come to an intersection and the light turns yellow, you're on notice that you need to slow down because what's coming next is the red light. So this concept of notice and due process, we deal with every day. We are not aware of that, but that starts with God. And so God will not judge the world unless he's first given them notice, told them what the standards are, and then he will hold them accountable. So we see the 10 commandments with the Hebrews, we see Maat, and then whether we want to get into the implications of what all Maat is, but we see negative confessions in Maat. They say, I have not slept with my neighbor's wife. I have not taken my neighbor's food, or things like that. Instead of saying, thou shalt not, it's, I have not. It's like when you die and you're trying to get into heaven or into the next life, you have to stand before a judge of some sort and confess these negative things. I have not stolen. I have not cheated. I have not done injustice. Where does all that come from? People put different packaging on it, but the knowledge and the awareness that you're not supposed to do those things comes from God. So revelation and vision comes from God. And it's not just in one narrow area, it's in all areas of life. God is communicating his vision. So then when we, as human beings, try to walk and to execute the basic requirements of human justice and righteousness, as we've been talking about just now, we do it with the authority and the mandate and the support of heaven. So this is what I call moral currency. It means we have status, we have something behind us. You know, when you get a dollar bill and it's a US Treasury note, what that piece of paper represents is that the US government's gonna back that. It's currency, I can spend that. It has weight, it can purchase things. But in the spiritual realm, there's moral currency. It's when you set out to do what is divinely right, what is just and what is right and what is fair, when you are obstructed by someone who is trying to prevent justice or righteousness from happening, you can spend your moral currency. You can stand there and say, I'm right and you're wrong. I don't care how many people are in my group. I don't care how many people you have. I don't care how many weapons you have. I don't care how many laws you have on the books. If you are opposing me and trying to execute and trying to enforce and trying to ensure that these basic rules of human behavior, which have existed for time immemorial, which again, I'm referring to as moral currency, then we as a group can spend our moral currency. When Dr. King went to Birmingham and they were directing the water hoses to these senior citizens, they were sicking the dogs on them, And they were locking up fourth graders and putting them in the paddy wagon, putting them in the jail. In that moment, Black people in Birmingham were spending moral currency, and it was having a moral impact. The images went around the world. President Kennedy was supposed to have a summit with the premier, who was like the president of Russia, who would be the equivalent. He was the equivalent of who is now Putin. When those images went around the world, the Russians, in the same sense that I talked about earlier with the Chinese when I was there in 2017, the Russians were playing those images on their state-run TV every day. Every day. And they were saying, and America says it's a democracy. This is what democracy looks like. So much so that Dr. King had been getting arrested, and they had a bail fund. Harry Belafonte and what's the guy's name? Dean Martin. They would have parties at their house, and they would raise money, and they had a bail fund. So they would protest, and then someone would be there once they got arrested to pay their bail, and they would get out. One of the strategists said, "Don't do that. Don't do that. Do not do that. When they arrest you, stay in jail. Because every day that you're in jail, every day that the jail is filled with Black people, is a day that America is on trial, a day that America's moral depravity, for lack of a better term, that a day that America's hypocrisy is on trial as it relates to the issue of race, as it relates to we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. And endowed by the Creator with certain inalienable rights, the right to what? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The Russians were saying, America's not living out this creed. Look at that. They're knocking senior citizens, women over with water hoses. They're grabbing them one on each hand. Four officers are carrying away a woman, an older woman, a 70-year-old woman. She's got a dress, her legs are sprayed. This is outrageous. So much so that President Kennedy called the mayor of Birmingham. He said, "Look, man, you're killing me. Get those people out of that jail and keep them out of the jail." What was happening? What was happening, folks? They were prepared to make sacrifices. They were spending moral currency. Whenever you stand up for what is right, please understand this, that people aren't going to celebrate you. And the establishment is not going to appreciate you, because for time immemorial, people who have advantage want to maintain the advantage. That doesn't make people in this country inherently more wicked than other people that have ever existed. It just makes them inherently normal. And we're still dealing with that right now. But we've got to make up our minds to spend some moral currency. And that often looks like inconveniencing yourself. But Jesus already told us that if you want to be my disciple, if you want to be a person of consequence, if you want to be a person of eternal impact, you must take up your cross, deny yourself, and follow in that order. You got to be dead to yourself. That's the only way that the group prospers. If it's just about you, I don't know. We're not going to make it. We can't make it as individuals. We have to make it as a group. And that's the word of the Lord, I think, to us right now. You're on the right team when we are advocating for justice and inclusion, not for privilege above any other group, but just to have the same, right? We're on the right team. We're on God's team, because God is not on the black team or the white team. God is on his team, and God is a God of justice. Justice is a moral imperative. It is a divine mandate. So when we begin to articulate and demand it, we are actually moving in the divine stream. So, but what is our vision for how we're going to get to the place that we need to get to? I want to talk about this concept also. As I've told you that There's moral currency. There's also counterfeit moral currency. That's when people want to act like they're doing the right thing. They want to appear to be moral, but in fact, they're just trying to gain political advantage. I gotta tell you folks, and some people may take issue with me, but I think for the last 40 years, the church, particularly the evangelical church, has been spending counterfeit moral currency. You know what I say? I'm gonna say it again, because I want it to be quoted. For the last 40 years in America, we have been spending counterfeit moral currency. What is that? What does that look like? Saying that we are about a certain lifestyle, demanding that everyone else live a certain way, and then behind the scenes, we're not even trying to live half that way in terms of the moral commitment. Jesus rebuked the Pharisees and the Sadducees and scribes, the religious establishment of his day, for that very behavior, Pharisaic behavior, where you appear spiritual. You go to the marketplaces of life and you dress in these long ornate robes and you pray these majestic prayers, but your heart, you draw nigh to me with your lips, with your mouth, but your heart is far, far from me. That's the kind of religion that we've seen in America, particularly among the evangelical church. And let me say this before you say, well, how can you criticize the evangelical church? I'm not throwing rocks at the house. I'm in the house. I consider myself to be, as in the old Church of God tradition, saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost, with a mighty burning fire. I am evangelical in the sense that I believe that it's in the mandate and the duty of Christians to share the good news of the gospel with everyone. But we have gone far away from that. We have not modeled anything. We've gone from trying to model to mandate. But see, God didn't call us to, Christ didn't call us to mandate anything. If you know church history, you know that the church was most powerful, most vibrant when it was being persecuted, when it was an illegal entity in the Roman Empire. We've got to call out. This is something that we can do as African Americans. I think that God has given us that calling. That's part of our mission, how we can both gain political and spiritual influence, is by calling out counterfeit moral currency, which tells people how they should live, but we ourselves are not going to constrain ourselves by the same standards. That's hypocrisy. The church has got a problem with credibility because the church is living a schizophrenic, bipolar-like existence in America. We are hypocritical. We are focused on all the things that the world is focused on, but God is saying, people, us, this community, step up. It doesn't require an election. It doesn't require an appointment by Congress or a ratification by the Senate, or Senate ratifies treaties, but it confirms people. It doesn't require any of that. It has been mandated in heaven, and here's where the revelation comes in. We have been tapped by God. Why? Because in the same way, you got to have listened to all the lectures. It's not because we are better. God chose Israel because they were the least. And in this country, and by many different measures, which we've talked about throughout this process, we are the least. So God loves to choose those who are down and out to work through so that only he gets the glory in the end. And in that context, I'm telling you that God has called us to stand up and to begin to speak the truth and to spend moral currency, to make the sacrifices and to call out hypocrisy and to call out where false currency or counterfeit currency is being spent in society. The church is all about mandating stuff and not about modeling anything in this country. And I throw down the gauntlet and say, it's time out for that. We need to live something. We need to inspire people. We don't need to be so engaged in insisting that people do anything, we need to inspire people to live righteous and holy by virtue of what they see in us. And God is calling us, our community, to lead the way. That's the vision that I have. And when we do God's bidding, when we do the work of the kingdom, when we make the work of the kingdom of God our number one priority, then God takes care of all of our business. And that includes those who are trying to oppress us, those who mean us harm, those who desire to push us back. And I heard some conversations about this, like in the last 2 weeks, there are people in this country right now who are talking about, literally openly talking about the fact that it might be beneficial for Black people to go back to slavery. You may think that that's outrageous, but Satan and evil and wickedness knows no boundaries. And that's why we have to push for it. In the outline, it says that there are two forms of power and influence. Political power, which is secular, you know, elected governments, appointed governments. We understand that. But then there's another kind of power, and that's moral power, moral authority or religious authority, which is what I'm talking about today, because it's a path, right? When you're not in the numerical majority in a country, how do you exercise influence? How do you get to your destination? One path is through moral influence. And we have it. How do we have it? Again, when I talk about moral and spiritual influence, remember, I'm not just talking about church and religion. You know, for whatever reason, people who are not Black, people who are not a part of our community, people who are not a part of our culture, love our music, love our art, our rap songs, our soul music. Why? Because there's something deeper about what we do that resonates with them. And we need to use that, because that's currency in the positive sense. We need to use our art to tell them what is right, to show them what is right, to encourage them to do what is right, not just for us, but for all human beings, but certainly for us as well, not to exclude us. Now then, I wanted to give you an example, and then I'm going to be through with my lecture. When we talked about this person in our early lectures, and we'll talk a little bit more, Egypt was an empire that existed for 3,000 years, 3,000. So I didn't get as far as China, but it was as old as China, but it just didn't last as long as China. But even a civilization that lasted for 3,000 years is worth studying. What did they do right? What did they do wrong? Well, what they did wrong is that there were tension within the nation. It's tension between tribes or local dominions. There was tension constantly between the priest and the pharaoh. That was just a constant thing. And when one was weak, the other was strong. So Egypt existed for 3,000 years, but they had three periods, which historians refer to as the intermediate periods. And that's just a nice way of saying that the central government broke down completely. Imagine that there's no government at all in Washington, D.C. For 200 years, this went on in Egypt. Can you imagine that? For 200 years, there are times during these intermediate periods where there was not one central government, but there was maybe 10 or 15 different regional governments, and they competed with each other until some strong man came back and rose up and reunited the kingdom, and then it went on, and that was what was called another dynasty. But Egypt had a total of 30 dynasties. The 25th dynasty, which is not celebrated, was founded by Black Africans from Kush, which is modern day Sudan. But remember, Sudan, the word Sudan is an Arabic term, which means the Black land. So there are Black people in every sense of the term. If you look at their images, Taharqa, which is mentioned in the Bible, coming to the assistance of Hezekiah when the Assyrians were coming to seize Jerusalem and Judah. It's in Isaiah, I believe, chapter 38, and it's in First Kings or Second Kings. You have to figure that out. Chapter 19, look, you'll see the man. It says he's an Ethiopian, but as I've shared with you before, whenever the Bible refers to Ethiopians, it's generally referring to Africans, people of dark skin, black skin from the continent of Africa. But generally, the term Ethiopian is used. It says that Taharqa was the king of the Ethiopians. We know that he actually was one of the kings, one of the pharaohs of the 25th dynasty. It's amazing. But how the 25th dynasty came into existence is that Egypt was going through one of those intermediate periods where the central government was falling apart. And why I shared this with you is because it seems to me as a student of history that we look like we're headed toward a intermediate period right here in the United States. So Taharqa and the Kushites were known for their military prowess. Nations from around the world, and that includes Persia, and that includes Assyria, and that even includes Egypt, hired them as experts. They were actually the secret service for the pharaohs, these black men. They had a special skill of being able to shoot an opponent's eye out from like 300 yards away with a bow and arrow. So they would be the equivalent of sharpshooters today. Kush, before it was called Kush, it was called Taseti, which by interpretation means the land of the bow, because they were tough. They were awesome. They were powerful brothers, literally in every sense of the term that we use that. But that's not how they conquered Egypt. How they conquered Egypt, how they established the 25th dynasty, was two things. I told you one, the central government was falling apart. The people were at odds with each other politically. They couldn't get on the same sheet of music, because I told you at the beginning of this lecture that political ideology is the weakest form of glue there is, politically, historically. And blood is the number one, then religion is the second. So what Alara, A-L-A-R-A, Alara, who was the founder of the 25th dynasty, what he discovered, what he understood, was when the political system is teetering on the verge of collapse, it is an opportunity that's presented for the religious people, the moral people, the people who have moral authority, to stand up and say, this is the way, follow it. So that's the strategy that he started, and his son Pianke, or his grandson Pianke, actually executed that. He did come with military might, but most importantly, he came and he said, look, we say we believe in this God. We say that there's certain things that we're supposed to do and certain things that we're not supposed to do according to Ma, which we talked about a moment ago. And we're not doing those things. Essentially what he said is we've been hypocritical. We have turned our back on our God, and it's time to renew our commitment to God. In other words, Pianke, who became one of the pharaohs, he didn't do it with the bow and arrow primarily. He did it with an appeal on the basis of moral authority. And you know what? Half of the Egyptians said, you're right. So they didn't have to do a lot of fighting, because when you move in the realm of morality, you have the army of heaven behind you. And you say, well, no, they were of a different religion. Listen very carefully to what I said. God has revealed himself to, in his minimal and basic expectations to all human beings throughout time, beginning with Adam and Eve, and after the flood, beginning again with Noah and his sons. So the Egyptians, no matter what they called it, or the Chinese had a concept called the mandate of heaven. Whenever the king did these basic things, or whenever the emperor did these basic things that we've been talking about, he had the mandate of heaven. But when he began to deviate from these basic requirements of justice and fairness and righteousness, he would lose the mandate of heaven. So yeah, they call it different things, but the reality is God has been speaking. And so what Pianke said to them is, look, we have deviated from the basic requirements of morality, and that's why our nation is weak. Let us come back. And in so doing, he was speaking, believe it or not, the mandate of heaven. Because God is committed not to Egypt or China or even Israel. He's committed to his rules. his statutes, his testimonies, his truth. And whoever is advocating for them, they will have the support of God. That's something that we need to contemplate for a moment. And why am I saying all this? Because I'm at the end of, because we are standing at a place where they're trying to strip us of our rights on paper right now. And they're doing it. They're making it more difficult for us to vote. They're taking Black legislative districts away. They're taking Black congressional districts away. The Supreme Court has directed Alabama, the Alabama state legislature, to give Black people another congressional district because we have the numbers. And the Alabama state legislature has said, forget you, we ain't gonna do nothing. The Supreme Court said do it, and they said, no, we're not gonna do it. So if our, as I've been saying, if our trust is in the laws, the codification, which we talked about last week or the week before, if our hope is in codification, we're out of gas. I know that's not a formal term, but I think you understand. Then we don't have hope. Thankfully, though, our hope is in God and the fact that he is committed to his word. Truth and justice and righteousness and fairness and equity is not a Black issue or a white issue. It's a God thing. And God's plan is always going to be done. So now then we have to formulate a vision for ourselves, for our children, and for them. Here's the thing. If we don't write out a plan for ourselves and for our children and their children, someone else will, our opponent will. In fact, I'm convinced that they have a long-range plan in terms of how they're going to take away the rights and the privileges that we have, because that goes back to the lecture that we had last week. While we like to celebrate as soon as possible when we make any grounds or gain any ground, they're plotting and planning. Who's they? Those who don't like justice, who don't think that everyone should have a seat at the table of brotherhood and equality. They're there. There's a large percentage of people who are Americans who feel as though we should stay in a subjugated state, and that's between them and God. But if we don't have a plan, by default, their plan will work. That's the importance of that. And a plan, again, as I've said, is not reacting when something bad happens, when someone is shot, when someone is killed, when someone is put in jail, when someone is wrongly convicted. We should react to all those things, but that should be secondary. What is our plan? What is our plan? How are we going to get to the place and the space that God put us here to walk in? Well, of course, by seeking God's face. This course is about me sharing with you what God has shared with me. That we're in a place, we're at a time, such a time as this, God has put us here in this country so that we can exercise some moral leadership. Yes, I said that. So that we, this community, can exercise some moral leadership in the sense that I've been talking about it throughout the course, not because we are better, but because we are actually the least. And that's who God likes to work with, so that God can be glorified, so that the name of God, so that the plan of God and the purpose of God can be elevated. So folks, that's it. We have to have vision. And what is the vision? And listen, people out there, you know, if someone is casting vision or talking about what they want to see, it's so easy to criticize and to say, well, why that won't work. There are so many critics out there, but not enough people who are willing to construct something that will work or to attempt something that will work. Maybe the first or the second thing that we try to do ain't going to work, but we got to try something. And again, if we don't write a vision and a plan for us, our opponent and our enemy's plan will work by default. So we got to start thinking. We've got to start visioning what a bright future and a better future looks like for us. I tell my family that our imagination, and they laugh me to scorn sometimes at the house now, we're only limited by our imagination. What kind of future can we imagine for our sons and daughters, for our students, for our neighbors. If someone handed us a pen and said, write the vision, what would we write? Thank you for your attentiveness. Now we're in the future, next lectures, we're going to go right into the heart of the matter, which is that we need to move. You know, Christianity was a movement, literally a movement. Everything that has happened, that has changed the world, didn't happen by someone sitting in a place and just thinking and hoping and wishing. We have to move. And I started this course out by talking about the fact that the earth rotates and tilts on its axis, and the Sahara Desert once was an oasis, but when the sun got at a certain angle, when the earth got at a certain angle, it caused all the vegetation to dry up, and the people that were living there had to move. That was the plan for salvation. Sometimes it's moving, getting into motion. That is all that human beings have done throughout recorded history, human history. They've moved. And so, speaking to this community, to our community, we have to move. We have to have a movement. But now, going forward, I'm going to talk about literally moving. And as a preview, I want, for those of you who are so inclined, to look at a documentary that's on HBO Max right now. It's called South to Power, and it's done by a New York Times writer, black guy named Charles Blow. He's from Louisiana, grew up there. He got a job and he lived in New York for 30 years, and he moved back to the South. I've read some of his writings, but this lecture and all the material that I'm sharing with you, I developed, or I shouldn't take credit, I will say the Lord revealed this to me before I knew that Charles Blow wrote about this and that he was going to do this documentary. But if you look at his documentary, which I commend to you, you're going to see a lot of the concepts that we're going to talk about in the next 2 weeks. The only difference between what Charles Blow is talking about and what I'm going to be talking about is that it is, I'm saying here that it is God's plan. It is actually the plan. It is, in other words, it's not on us to make it happen. We have to be willing and open to walk in the plan, whatever the vision is, but it's God himself who's initiating it and orchestrating it, and he will bring it to cultivation and to maturity, and it will happen. That's what I'm saying. So I have a divine perspective that I'm offering in addition to the secular perspective, but the secular conversation and aspect of it, it's in the documentary, it's on HBO Max called South to Power. I commend that to you. It's a good, I've watched it twice. I commend it to you to watch. But we're out of time in terms of our lecture. It's time to, I see there's at least one comment or question. Can you read that, someone, for me?
I can. It says, please share any thoughts. Oh, the comment was just a message to everybody to send, to share any comments that they have.
Okay, so that was just a thought. Now let me open it up, because in the worksheet, which I hope that you're taking the time to look at and to complete as we go, the question is asked, if you had the opportunity to write the 100-year plan, tell me what are some of the things that would be going on for Black people 100 years from now, anyone?
I have mine.
Go ahead, Terry.
Okay, so it would be a Black system that was for Blacks, created by Blacks, in the sense not to exclude other people, but these people in these capacities would know our passions, our plights, and I'd be looking at our best interests, the lawyers, the doctors, the professors, the contractors, literally, you know, people that build the homes in California. You're not finding these people of color, commercial businesses, definitely not seeing them. They're so far apart in where I can find them. And just things like stores. The Ralphs would be the girlies or something like that, where you can see that we exist. Our money is going into everybody else's, all these things. Mm-hmm. But to have it going to the business owner, like I was watching that documentary with you, and the guy said, hey, the customers are us. the owners are us, the managers are us. That's a sense of validation. Mm-hmm. And I think that would be important. Those are the things I definitely would be make sure that was implemented and stayed into place.
Thank you for sharing, Terry. You know, the Charles Blow was talking about Atlanta, Georgia, where he goes to the restaurant and the manager's black, the waiters are black. He goes to a department store, shoe store, the owner's black, the manager's black. And it's just this, he used the term, he is being bathed in blackness. Again, not to the exclusion of any other group, but the fact of the matter is in the West, we are bathed in European ideas and thoughts, and European ideas and thoughts are the model. Not speaking for or against them, but there are other people in the world. So it's good to see people who literally look like you being successful. It inspires you. It impacts you at a level that is beyond our cognitive ability to appreciate. So he talks about this, he refers to this as being bathed in blackness. And Atlanta is such a place. Jackson, Mississippi is in some sense that place, but it's not as economically prosperous as Atlanta. Atlanta is a place where a lot of black people since the 1990s have migrated toward, moved. Remember, we're talking about movements, literally moved there, because it's a place where they can thrive in a, like a little bubble where they don't, it's not a panacea, it's not a paradise. Paradise doesn't exist on planet Earth since Adam and Eve got kicked out of paradise. But it's a place where race doesn't play a negative role, the substantially negative role that it tends to play in places where you are one of few who look like you, where you're not a minority. And again, this is something that has existed for time immemorial. This is why I started out this conversation talking about the Hans Chinese, 90% of the Chinese, a billion of them. They are one family, a billion people. And they may have a lot of things going on, but one of them is not, I'm being discriminated against because I'm Hans Chinese, because everybody's Hans. And it's a weight that they don't have to deal with. And it's an invisible weight, and sometimes it's quite visible weight that we have to deal with on a daily basis. And Charles Blow and Jerry Gurley is telling us and advocating that one way that we can manage that, again, not creating a utopia, but one way we can manage a serious weight that we're dealing with on a daily basis. And sometimes it's an invisible weight. We can't really know how much we're under that weight until we go into another space. My daughter, Brooke, talked about the fact when she was an undergraduate, when she went to Ghana, I think it was, Accra, and she got off the plane and she saw all these black people, and the college professors were black, the doctors were black, the police officers were black. She said she actually felt something palpable, tangible. So there's a spiritual, there's an invisible weight that weighs on you if you're in a culture and in a place and in a country where historically black people have been considered to be less than, because even though the laws have changed, there's a residue of that thinking that has remained. And it's impacting us when we are candidates for jobs. I often talk about the study that was done by Princeton, where you had people applying for a job and they had different profiles. One was a black man with a bachelor's degree, and another was a white man with a high school diploma and a prison record. And consistently, employers chose the white man with a high school diploma and a prison record over the black man with the bachelor's degree. The only way that we can account for that objectively is race.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the ability. We do not need an act of Congress to manage that, but it does require movement. It does require that. It does require vision. It does require some degree of sacrifice. See, we can't have it both ways. We can't say we want to be comfortable, but we're not willing to make sacrifices to get to the place of comfort. All right, let me hear from someone else, if you care to share your vision of this space that exists 100 years from now, what Black people are doing or not doing.
Else? While they're thinking, I can I ask a question?
Sure.
I mean, someone's about to say something. Go ahead.
Go ahead, someone.
Oh, no. Okay. I have a question. Do you think, I'm just being, how they say, play devil's advocate or whatever, that Black people believe, or maybe I want to say fear, because, you know, we had a Black Wall Street, right? I've heard the Black Wall Street.
Yeah.
And do you feel that maybe Black people feel that if they try to become too much again, the same thing will happen to them? Or so that, like in America, we couldn't ever have that, we'd have to go to someplace like Africa. I'm sure that must be, you know, I'm not the only one that's heard about it, and I don't know all the specifics, but at one time we had all this, and it was zapped from us, right? So is it possible they're thinking, I ain't going through that again. I'm just, you know, let you say me, my four, and no more. I'm not going to try and, you know, get together with other people.
Yeah, I think that's a good question, Terry. And the answer to that question is no doubt some people have that idea in their head that no matter how we try, we can't beat the system. So we might as well not try. Terry, if you recall, you know, our dad was given to lecturing us about different things. And one of the things that he lectured us about is how they train an elephant. And the elephant is a baby, they chain him to a pole, and the chain is fairly thin, but it's sufficient to hold that baby elephant in place when the elephant keeps trying to pull away. So at some point, the elephant, who's now 10 tons, who can snap that chain with one toe, doesn't try, because in his mind, the chains have transferred from his body to his mind, and he doesn't think of doing anything outside the boundaries that have been set by him by the controlling authority of the power. So yes, there are people, lots of people in our community who have the chains still on their mind by design. And so, in fact, I would say the default position is one that we have to work for someone else. We have to get approval for everything that we think about that is good and perfect and desirable. Someone else outside of our community need to sign off on that, or we shouldn't try it, we shouldn't do it, or it's not worth doing, or it's not legitimate. So that's all of the vestiges, that's all the residue, that's all of the negative repercussions of slavery and Jim Crow and segregation and convict leasing that we're still living with, that we're not even cognizant of. So yes, we're dealing with that, but then what dispels that, what deals with that, is vision. And I feel like this course and what God has pressed in my spirit is, look, I'm concerned about the world. I sent Jesus to save the world. And I'm concerned about Charlie. And Christ had Charlie or Jan, Bob or Larry on his mind when he hung out on Calvary, but he also had an entire group of people. And we don't have a problem embracing that when we're talking about a nation like Israel. Of course, that's God's chosen people. But what we don't realize is that Israel's relationship with God is prototypical, meaning that God entered into that relationship so that he could give an example of how he wants to deal with other nations collectively as a group.
Okay.
And again, I'm saying we're not above, but we're not beneath, and God has a plan, and we need to be about seeking that plan and walking in that plan, which begins with vision. What is our plan? Because we don't come up with a plan by default, our opponent's plan, which you can trust and believe there is a plan, it will win out.
Okay.
Not seeing any further comments or thoughts. Folks, let me tell you, thank you for joining us on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. I apologize that we have bounced around, but there have been some events that were beyond my control. We will do it again next Saturday at 10 o'clock, if the good Lord's willing, and the creek don't rise. The creek has been trying to rise here and there. But it's very important, and we're doing this for posterity. I'm giving this lecture because I'm doing this lecture and doing this class because I think history matters and current events matter primarily because we need to get some direction and we need to get some perspective on where we've been and where we need to go. And I'm telling you unapologetically, we've got to move. We've got to move. A movement, the civil rights movement, it was not stagnant. It was moving, changing the status quo. All right.
Can I say one more thing where we go?
Hold on. Oh, okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Go ahead, Terry.
Can I say, I just wanted to say something.
You can ask another question, sure.
No, I'm just, well, not a question so much as a statement, a comment about what you were saying about the church system. Not how before being in the church of in our lifetime, which is 62 years, and I've only known myself to be in the church, how being in the church back then, say back then versus now, having a title, reverencing when you hear someone say elder someone or missionary someone, they got a certain reverence and respect that was associated with, you didn't have to know them personally, but what was an ideal of what was portrayed of what their lifestyle is, which as you say now, they've lost that. That was a good in. That was a big influence on your behavior, you know, in the presence of somebody, you know, sister so-and-so, brother so-and-so, ours is brother Green and whatever like that. Mm-hmm. The different people, they held a certain, the church itself had a certain title or impression or representation that was implied that these people in these titles lived a certain way. Now, for all we know, they probably could not have, but now it's like you said, it's publicly where you can see these people hold these titles, but it's more like a business. No one is perceiving it anymore, I feel like, what it was initially started out to be. Right. If I'm tired of living and being misused in the world, I'm going to go and find solace. And I'm gonna get built up in the house of the Lord, whatever that be, Baptist, whatever. And now it's gotten to the point where you're saying, it's like, I'm telling you, don't do this and don't mind, you know, what they say, do as I say, not as I do, has right. really come to the forefront. And I think that hurts us because religion is a big influence. And if these people are holding these things that they say in the Bible that they're preaching, I think that they would have a better input in the community and can hold these meetings in churches and say, hey, we as a people need to do this. But you hear people have a really negative attitude or opinion of churches now. And right.
And I think that that's a deserved and earned opinion. We've been.
Yes, but it's hurting us.
We've been behaving hypocritically, but we can be a critic. This is something that the Lord spoke to me about a long time ago, or we can construct. Where we can exercise moral authority, moral leadership by constructing a true church of Jesus Christ that lives it out, it inspires, that lets the light shine through us so that men may see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. And for that work, there is a reward, both in this day and time, and of course, in the world to come. So I see that there's a comment or a statement. There's a couple something in the chat. I want to make sure I clear all the chat out.
It just says happy Saturday.
Oh, that's it. Okay. Happy Saturday to you, I think that was said.
Happy Saturday.
What are the two sources, according to the outline or according to this lecture, what are the two sources of authority in a given society?
I had that one.
We covered that.
Ideology, economics, and military political. What are the two basic sources?
The two basic.
Ideology. Ideology.
Ideology. Or we'll just say political influence, okay, right? And what was the other one? We've been hitting that for forever. Moral influence.
Moral.
And what is moral currency, by the way? Anyone want to answer that?
Faith in God.
Faith in God, okay. But in addition to that, so okay, how does that look? And you know, when you say I have faith in God, so how does that look in terms of when I say currency, when I spend that, that means when I act in currency, and I gave the illustration of the dollar bill. That dollar bill says the government, the United States government, will back this up. When we, in the spiritual sense, spend moral currency, that means God himself, heaven, is behind us in what we're doing. So in what ways do we spend moral currency, if you recall? And that's the last question. You guys have been great on a Saturday morning. If not, go back.
By governing our
please. And
by governing ourselves and being moral.
Right. Yes, Terry. First and foremost, we need to live the life, as they used to say in the Church of God in Christ. We got to live the life. Talking is all right. Singing is all right. Praying is all right. But you got to live the life. That's what they used to say. It's still true. Still true. Have a blessed day. Have a blessed week. Talk to you next week.
All right. Bye.